I'd like to call the meeting of the Zoning Board of Appeals of Tuesday, December 6th, to order. With the absence of Chairman Davis this evening and Acting Chairman Savino, the first order of business is to appoint a chairperson pro tem to act as our secondary acting chairperson whenever the acting chairperson is absent. That being said, is there a motion to elect a member as a second acting chairperson to the Zoning Board of Appeals?
Make a motion to nominate Steve Young as the acting chair.
Second?
I'll second.
Good. That being said, Steve is our acting chair, and now the meeting is yours.
Did we need a vote?
Oh, yes. That Can we have a vote on that, please? Thank you.
Aye.
Voice vote.
Aye.
Aye.
Good?
Any opposed?
Aye.
Any abstentions?
Okay.
Aye.
We're good. It's you.
Teach you to come in.
Yeah, really. Good evening, everybody. I'd like to call a roll for the Zoning Board of Appeals meeting. We'll call it to order. Let's start the roll.
Bulin?
Here.
Capetta?
Here.
Emery?
Here.
Zimmer?
Here.
Young?
Aye. Here. Since we have a quorum, it seems like I think we only have one item on the agenda this evening to review. But before we do that, we have a motion to approve previous meeting minutes.
So moved.
And seconded.
Actually, before I do that, are there any corrections or addendums that need to be put into it?
No.
So the motion has been moved and seconded. We take a quick vote. Voice vote?
Aye.
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 Abstain. Goes into your list.
Oh, okay. That's motion, so the motion carries.
So the motion carries for now. So we have a motion and seconded and approved for the minutes that have been approved for this previous meeting. Let's move on to unfinished business. I don't think we have anything left over from the previous minute. So let's move on to new business. Right now, it looks like the only item that we have on the agenda is regarding our two district signage regulations regarding for churches. Am I correct in that? So, if you wouldn't mind, we have two people in the audience that are going to provide a presentation. Would you do me a favor and both stand up and introduce yourself first?
Good evening. My name is Walter Morrissey. I'm the attorney for Christ Church, associated with the law firm of Lowick and Thorsness here in Oak Brook.
David Melvin, Chief Administrative Officer, Executive Director at Christ Church of Oak Brook.
Are you both planning on providing testimony?
Yes, sir.
Could I ask you to raise your right hand and get sworn in? Do you swear and affirm that the testimony that you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
Excellent. Let's proceed with the presentation then.
Good evening. We're here this evening on the application for a text amendment on behalf of Christ Church of Oak Brook. We do have a slide presentation this evening to accompany the application. The first slide merely shows the property of Christ Church of Oak Brook at the intersection of 31st and York, Oak Brook Road and York Road. The second picture shows the view from the west, an aerial view from the west looking at the Christ Church of Oak Brook property. This slide shows a view from the north looking at the Christ Church of Oak Brook property. You can see the opening for the golf course here, and you can see the homes along Lincoln and Grant and Coolidge, and then the golf hole over along York Road. The first, the reason why we're here this evening, first let me give you some background. Christ Church was established in 1965. The traditional sanctuary was opened in April 1970. We were released recently before the village and received approval for an amendment to our special use permit. We also received approval of a final plat of consolidation, which consolidates some individual parcels into a 24-acre parcel of land at that intersection of Oak Brook Road and York Road. We're here this proposing an amendment to Section 1311-12C of the ordinance, which has to do with signage in the R2 district. If you look at the ordinance, you'll see that there's a gap. It just merely refers to non-residential uses of signage in the R2 district. It doesn't refer to churches. So that's why we decided that we should come before the Zoning Board of Appeals and present our case to you. It's that silence in the ordinance. We'd like to fill that gap and clarify what churches can do with signage so that we're consistent with the other sign ordinances in the village. We're proposing a three-part text amendment to Section 1311-12C. Part one has to do, and it says, and I point out, that it applies to a church where the lot, parcel, or tract of land is 10 acres or more. So there's only two parcels in the entire village that this applies to, so there can be no precedent and it can't be relied upon for other parcels other than with that qualifying. And what we have, the first part of the ordinance is to permit to have a freestanding identification sign at the gateway of the church. We have a 35-year-old sign that's composed of railroad ties that's at the intersection of the corner of Oak Brook Road and York Road. And we're proposing with this to specifically say that a church in the R2 district may have an identification principle, freestanding identification sign to replace the one that we have that's 35 years old today. Do you want to go to the next slide? The second part of this is a slide that shows you the location of the existing signage and where the church wishes to put the new sign at that intersection. This is an illustration of the proposed sign that would be placed at the, as our freestanding principal identification sign at that corner of our property. As you can see, it's done tastefully. It's done with restraint to be compatible with the church design and architecture, as well as to be compatible with the neighbors in the community. The next plan is a plan that we submitted as part of the application that's in the case file that the staff has. It shows the landscaping that would be attend to that freestanding sign so that it's it will be have vegetation around it. Some of it will be perennial, some will be annual, but the sign will be tastefully landscaped. This is an overhead aerial view of the sign. You can see the relationship to the corner and how it will fit into that existing area. Where that happens to be the landscape, a picture of the landscape architect and our maintenance manager, and that's exactly where the sign, where they're standing, where that sign will be, and you can see the 40-year plus old sign in the distance right behind them that's there. So we're right at that same area to put the sign in for the principal identification sign for the church. The uniqueness of this proposed text amendment is that it applies only to 10-acre tracts that have churches on them. There are only two of those in the village. There's this tract, and then there's a tract at Midwest Road and 31st Street. This is the second part of the proposed text amendment, and what that relates to are the monument signs that we would like to have. Pardon me? This is the wall sign. I'm sorry. One identification wall sign per street frontage with the name, logo, and symbol. The special use amendment that was approved in the last year allows the church to construct a new contemporary worship venue, and this would be the wall sign on that building. Here's an illustration. You can see the existing traditional sanctuary here that opened in 1970. This is the proposed contemporary worship center with the identification sign on the wall there. The do you have the next slide? This is the third part of the proposed text amendment, which relates to allowing what are called monument signs under the ordinance to provide identification and directional instructions at the access drive that's opposite Lincoln. The purpose of this sign is to provide directional information for access, exit, and egress to the property, and make it easy for people that are visiting the church to see it at that point. Now, here's an illustration of where the monument sign would go. It's in the on Oak Brook Road there at the access driveway opposite Lincoln Road. And that's a full access driveway, and it would do is give people directions coming in or out, easily identifiable for emergency vehicles coming in, and also notifies traffic, because across the street at that point there's residences, and then a little bit to the west you have the Sports Corps property. This is a picture, this is a depiction of what the monument sign would look like at that access driveway. Now, the standards that the ZBA will apply are set forth in section 13, ordinance 13-14-6. First standard is the reasonable return or use on the property. We think it's essential to public safety and public welfare that we do have a monument sign to control the access driveways of the property. We also think the identification sign at the intersection, that's a gateway location for people that are traveling eastbound or westbound on Oak Brook Road, or the traffic, north-south traffic on York Road. And in our application, we have stated that the freestanding gateway sign basically identifies the church. It would be appropriate and restrained to identify what the function of the church is and its property location. The second standard is the plight of the owner due to unique circumstances. As we indicated, the church was founded in 1965 as a result of the benefaction of Paul Butler, the founder of the village, with a contribution of the land. The traditional sanctuary was built in 1970. The church, the design and aesthetics of the church are compatible with the high standards of the village. And we take note that there, over the past decade, there has been substantial luxury homes and so-called estate homes that have been built around the church, both to north of the church at Lincoln, Grant, and Coolidge, as well as across York Road on the east side of that street. The church has grown as the neighborhood and the community have grown, and has done so in a compatible and harmonious way. The third standard for the ZBA to apply to this is that the text amendment will not affect the essential character of the locality. And I think we have clearly the design and of these signs is restrained. It's appropriate to the community. It's in keeping with other signs that identify, for example, York Woods or Brook Forest or other areas of residential living, because we do live in an R2 district. We are located in R2 district. Here's an example of the Forest Preserve District sign. Here's a Brook Forest sign that we think is compatible. Here's an Oakwood sign. And we've attempted to, in spirit as well as in reality, come up with designs that are compatible and fit that. Having dealt with the three standards that the Zoning Board of Appeals will apply in their deliberations this evening, the rules of procedure for the Zoning Board of Appeals in Section 10, Decimal 3 set forth a list of factors that the board is also to take into consideration when considering a text amendment to the ordinance. The first standard, the first factor, factor A, is the character of the neighborhood. We're suggesting that we replace a 40-year-old plus sign with a updated sign that is restrained, that's appropriate, and aesthetically is in keeping with signage in the surrounding neighborhood, as well as with the quality of the structure that the church has already. We think that it will be compatible with the neighborhood. It will be a sign of invitation, but it will not be garish, nor will it cause distraction to people in the community. Factor B under the item is the extent to which property values.
And I don't want to interrupt you, but for the members of the board, if you want to follow along, you can identify all these in the packet on D2,
right.
D3, D4. And I'm not necessarily sure we want to go through all these one by one. Are there any objections to giving an abbreviated version of that?
I'm fine with that.
All good.
All right.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will proceed then. We will adopt and incorporate in full for the record the statement in support of the application that's contained in the case file. In terms of addressing those items, we do not believe that the property values will be diminished by this proposed text amendment. We think the churches and schools in the R2 district are neutral in terms of property values. You know, we have Butler School, District 53 school just immediately north of us on the east side of York Road. Their signage is appropriate and in the public interest. The quality of the signage and the appropriate landscaping, accompanying landscaping, will be in character with the commitment of the church to be a good neighbor. The church is making a substantial investment in terms of monetary, in terms of the brick and the landscaping to be done and the design. In terms of the neighborhood has frankly thrived over the last decade. If you look at the building permits that have been pulled, we've noted earlier in our comments that the homes are certainly in the upper bracket, the luxury and estate style homes on 2 acre plus lots, many of them in keeping with the character of the village. Suitability, we're bordered by the Forest Preserve of DuPage County on the west, and there are walking and hiking trails in there. We also, at our last hearing before you, we've left the lot known as 3306 York Road, which is the buffer to Robin Hood Ranch. We've left that as vacant and in an as-is condition without improvements as part of our commitment to the community and our immediate neighbors. The property has been zoned in the R2 since it's back since 1960. We have golf courses and the sports core on the opposite side, so we think this is a compatible use. This property, as we have indicated, has been operated as a church since 1965. The church acquired the lots known as 3202, 3212, 3222, and 3306 York Road through the years. Those have been consolidated into a final plat of consolidation by ordinances recently approved with the village. I think there is public gain here, and one, we will provide appropriate signage for access to the property from a safety standpoint for emergency vehicles. There is pedestrian traffic within the property on the parking lots and surrounding it, so the signage will be helpful to that as well. And we think we also know that this will allow us to have better access for handicapped and senior citizens that need signage to get them to the close proximity to the facility so they don't take the long walk that the younger people do from the distant points in the parking lot. The signage also, we view the church as part of our commitment to the community as a gateway. for the village. Basically, the traffic that's coming westbound on Oak Brook Road comes to that intersection of York after they cross over 294. They come to the gateway entrance there, and there's a, we think, a in good taste signage that is appropriate to the village and connotes the high standards that the village maintains throughout all of its activities. Mr. Chairman, I'll be happy to answer any questions or more detail that any of the members of the Zoning Board of Appeals may have.
Sure. Before we get started on that, Gail, I understand we're in receipt of some recommendations that were made by the Planning Commission. Can we get a summarization of what those were? I think you can review those on pages 9 and 9A, correct? Is it possible to do?
Yes. Plan Commission member Doyle had the suggestion in part three of the proposed new text amendment that the signage be on each of two sides of the signs, the monument sign, so that that monument sign that's opposite Lincoln, that the it's clear that the language and the directional arrow and the arrow and so forth be on both sides of the sign. So we added each to it. There was another, the second, and the church agreed with that at the Plan Commission meeting. We accept that and we support it, and we've added it into the text of the proposed amendment as a result of that. The second comment that Plan Commission member Doyle had to do with interior signage, and we're sympathetic to the interior signage because interior signage obviously gives directions to the people that are in the, David, if you bring up the picture of the we have a picture of the lot. Here's the interior signage that Commissioner Member Doyle was talking about, was to direct people, particularly for our seniors and our handicap. And what we concluded with discussion on that, if you look at Ordinance 13-11-6E, that deals with on-site informational signs, and it clearly says that it allows these signs, interior signs, to be are permissible anywhere in the R2 district for that purpose. So the conclusion was that a text amendment was not required on the interior signs. The ordinance already covered that in Ordinance 13-11-6E.
Got it. Is there anyone from the audience that wants to make any comments? Such as it is. If not, let's move on to any questions from the board.
Go ahead, Jeff.
Seamer?
Start at that and we'll work our way.
Yeah, on the three parts, I understand one and three, you know, to give the updated signage on
yes.
the corner and, you know, the entrance and exiting, I get that. The building signage, currently there's no signage on the building, correct?
That's correct.
Okay, and if I read the current regulations, right, it's limited to non-residential buildings within the district, shall have no more than 16 square feet, and you're requesting 200 square feet per building, per side.
Here is the...
It seems rather excessive.
The picture of it, or the illustration of that signage, that would be on the... that would be the west corner of the new building towards the forest preserve in the parking lot. And it would be that, it would be the signage right in that area there.
16 square feet would be about this big.
Pardon me?
16 square feet would be about this big.
We're saying 16 square feet would be about that size.
But if I read it verbatim, I mean, I could interpret this as you have multiple buildings here.
We limited to one per street exposure, so there...
Oh, it says one per building per street.
We don't want multiple signage on...
I didn't think you would. That's why I'm trying to clarify what that
it
might
should
be.
It should be one on the new Contemporary Worship Center and one on the other street side if it's ever put in. Not on each building, no. I would look at that as one building, not separate buildings. So I went.
I'm just trying to potentially head off an issue. That's all.
No, we agree. We agree with that. It should be considered one building for purposes of the exposure. Mm-hmm. To this is a north exposure, and it would be one exposure.
So do we need to clarify that? I mean, it's a little ambiguous.
It said, if I was to go back and reread that.
Two per building affixed against a building wall, limited to an area not more than two.
Per building.
Per building.
Right.
And in essence, this building is under one roof.
By multiple structures under one roof.
Right.
But it could be multiple structures.
Correct.
So I'm okay with saying one campus.
One per campus.
Campus, yeah, per major street side or something like that.
Why not clarify that then to say against a facility, so treat it as a mm-hmm. single facility, clarify that it's a single facility or building.
Or limit one. Two per facility affixed against a building wall.
Yes.
And I think that would hit what you're trying to achieve.
That's what we're trying to achieve.
So is that okay?
So instead of per building, you want per...
It would be per facility affixed against a building wall.
Do we define facility, or are we just changing our issue?
Yeah.
I think we're just changing our...
Facility complex, yeah.
I think we still have an undefined term. I mean, we've tried to make it better, but we're still kind of...
Do we want to say campus? Would that be
easier? Yeah, I was going to suggest campus.
Campus.
That way it's any... collection of buildings that are on that 10-acre parcel.
That 10-acre parcel.
Right.
It's all under one roof. It's not separate structures, correct? So are you
correct.
Saying...
Correct. It's one building. It's one building. They're all one roof.
So per structure.
No. But is the question...
My issue is if you built a separate standalone structure in the future, you could put
another
200 square feet sign on that.
Per facility.
The concern was...
Theoretically, but we would have to come in and get an amendment to the special use to build a standalone building, and it might... But I understand this is the time to clarify the issue.
Correct. I mean, we're trying to hit what you're trying to achieve, the spirit of that, and we're just trying to clarify that so that there is no confusion.
A broader collective of term.
How about limit two per tract of land?
That works better.
Mm-hmm. Right, and that's referenced in the...
My suggestion would be to do one wall sign per frontage.
One wall sign per frontage.
Okay.
But is...
For street frontage.
But then it doesn't specify a building.
Street frontage.
Right. Because the question becomes, because again, there are two properties where this would apply, mm-hmm. and not to have problem with the number of tracts of land, but that might be also very confusing.
Because there could be multiple tracts.
Right, and there could be also multiple buildings on a future lot,
right.
10 acres. So,
Walter, how many acres does the church have?
Instead of suggesting campus.
Slightly over 24 acres.
Okay.
Saying limit it to one wall sign per street frontage. So that would give you one on York Road and one on Oak Brook Road.
Per street frontage. It says one wall sign per street frontage.
Frontage, but then it says two per building.
Right.
That's what we're...
you can correct me if I'm wrong, when this was originally written in anticipation, were you considering the fact that there was two parts to the name as two different signs, or
no? We were thinking of a wall sign on the York Road exposure at some point in time. If the addition was built on that, it was in the original plan.
So you were anticipating possibly a need for a second sign.
But it's clearly our intent is one wall sign per frontage. And limited to that.
I think with that modification, I think that would clarify.
Yeah, we can always go back on vote and discuss it.
Can you read it again? Where were we?
I'm just seeing if it sounds redundant, that's all. That'd be permitted.
So it's the identification wall sign per street frontage, but we're eliminating the verbiage
two per building.
Of...
Limit two per
building. Limit two per building. That's what we're eliminating.
Just
correct.
Take that, strike that.
Just strike out limit two per building?
Uh-huh.
That's what you're saying?
That's probably, yeah.
Unless that changes the intent of the applicants.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear your question.
They're suggesting to remove the words limit to per building so that it reads one identification wall sign per street frontage with the name, logo, and symbol affixed against a building wall and projecting out to 12 inches and may be illuminated according to code, limited in area to not more than 200 square feet.
The church would agree to delete the language or remove the language limit to per building. I think it makes it very clear because the church's intent all along is one wall sign per street exposure for the entire complex. So if you have two street exposures, you can have one on each street exposure. If you had five street exposures, you could have five. We don't. We have two exposures, one on York and one on Oak Brook Road.
Okay. Can you explain to me the limited in area to not more than 200 square feet? I mean, when are you going to have a sign that's 200 square? I don't understand that line. On the building, I'm talking about on the building.
Yes. And so the idea is that this is a pretty large building.
Right.
And if we had a very small sign, it would not even look appropriate for this size building. We're trying to make this not look like a warehouse, which is right. Why we're adding the little flare up here and then something that marks the church as Christ Church.
Is that relatively?
How big is that sign?
Yeah.
How big is that sign? Is that
sign dimensions, as the architect has concepted this, 27, 8 inches by 6 feet, 6 inches.
That's 30 by 120.
Yeah. So what we're trying to do is help provide a rewrite in the code that would apply to any church. And we're using us as an example, as a practical example. And frankly, we just looked at this concept drawing and said, well, how big is that? And we came up with that.
I mean, I'm looking at the structure compared to the church. It doesn't look that big. That needs 200 square feet of a sign. This picture doesn't make it look that big.
We don't want it any bigger in relation to that. And if it ends up being smaller, we would. But the dimensions that the architect gave us is that size. So.
And right now, it's still fairly restrictive, too. I mean, if you look at staff recommendations, there's only two churches in the village
right.
that meet the
neither
of
them have
for this.
Wall signage
no,
currently.
Right. No.
No?
No.
They don't have wall signage.
Oh.
Okay.
Is there...
I have a question.
Yeah. I have a couple of questions.
For Buehling.
In paragraph number 3, regarding the entrance monument, the drawings and everything are basically showing the one across from Lincoln. But in the paragraph, it says access drives, plural. And you do have two access points on 31st and two on York. So that means you could add monumental signs.
I have, as I've been involved in the whole process and evolved this whole thing, I think that a monument entrance works well at a full access drive. I don't think it's appropriate at a right-in, right-out. I see us eventually, someday, addressing York Road. I don't see it anytime in the near future.
Okay. But right now, with it being plural, you could have four monument signs at each, because it doesn't restrict it to right-in, right-out, so...
I would leave that up to your wisdom. I do think that we would definitely want one on the east side or on the York Road side eventually.
Eventually,
so that would be
right,
plural.
Because you have a right in, I mean, you have both
full
sets
access,
there.
Right. And it is confusing as you even come down York Road and you see a no left turn sign.
Correct.
But that's actually for the right in, right out. I'd like to be able to see where you actually can go.
And that right in or that right out from the daycare. Everybody makes the left
that other
anyway.
One that too.
So, but yeah, that sign is confusing because you think it's no left at the next intersection too. So, or no right at the next intersection.
So the reason for the multiple here is to make sure that we're not limiting ourselves from doing that on York Roadside eventually.
Do we want to have some sort of limit?
Or Bill, can you propose something that we can discuss?
I mean,
You could write the full access drive, and that will take
and just call it a full access, not a right in, right.
Right, just make it a full access entrance or whatever.
So add the word full right here.
Right, and you're done.
Yeah, add full access drives.
Okay. Gail, did you catch that?
Yes, I did. We're just inserting the word full there.
And I have one other comment, only because we're talking about the full access entrance at, across from Link. And in previous, many previous discussions with the church, there were issues regarding the crosswalk at that location. These engineering and landscape plans don't show anything regarding that. Are we not doing any sort of crosswalk there?
Or? Oh, no, we absolutely will.
Okay.
We don't have a sidewalk over here.
Correct.
We'd still work out with the village exactly where we put that.
Okay.
There's no question we'll be doing it. And the other recommendations that came through our process.
We agreed, the Christ Church agreed that we would work with staff. We'll have to make a joint application to the DuPage County Department of Highway and get their approval on the exact location of where that crosswalk will be. But that was part of the commitment that was made that we would cooperate in good faith with the village to get that accomplished.
Okay.
Are there any other questions?
Yes, it's not in regard to the text amendment, but in regard to the sign. Is that sign made out of wood? The freestanding sign?
The corner sign?
Yes.
I believe it would be a combination of materials. Again, this is concept, but yes, we would put the same kind of wood here that we have on the wall on the new facility back there. It's a, I'm not an architect, but there's some, Ipe? Yeah. Ipe, which is a very durable, attractive kind of wood. It would not be the railroad tie look that we have right now.
That's what I was. Another thing on the full access drive, I'm assuming you're going to have projection lights on the sign?
We would have lighting that it fits.
Is that
going to
be low profile so it won't interfere with the traffic?
It would not interfere with traffic. Okay. And nor would we make it so residents could see it from their house.
Okay. Thanks.
So right now we have spotlights shining up, but we're still working through this. Again, this is concept. We'll follow the code.
And the lighting would probably be in conformance with the village lighting standards anyways, correct?
Yes.
Any other questions?
Steve's not here today.
Steve's not here
today.
Any other comments?
Good.
I think we're good. So, having the standards already been previously addressed, and they're written and contained. You can find them in the case file in D2 through D4, right?
Right.
And we have testimony from the applicant. Is there a motion to approve the request? Now, before we do that, we've added two changes that we want to make to it, correct?
Correct.
Would you mind pulling back up for the benefit? So we're adding in the words, actually a word.
And next one.
We're removing the language here, limit two
right.
per building.
So we're going to eliminate
that.
The
language will be
limit
stricken.
Two per building, and we're adding in fully.
Full.
And we'll add in full access drives.
And also that each that is added in there was a recommendation from the Plan Commission.
Yeah.
Do you agree with the Plan Commission's recommendation?
I'm okay with that.
That's fine.
So with the changes and the recommendations of the Plan Commission, do we have a motion to approve the request?
So moved.
Second.
Gail, did you catch it?
Yes, I did.
Let's call the roll.
Ulan?
Yes.
Capetta?
Yes.
Emery?
Yes.
Zimmer?
Yes.
Young?
Yes. Acting as chair. So I'm not sure if my vote counts this time
it
around
counts.
Or not.
It counts.
This time.
So the motion has been moved and seconded, and Gail, would you please let the applicant know what our next steps are?
Okay, the next step
been
is
approved as voted on.
The next step is this will be before the Village Board of Trustees on Tuesday, January 10th at 7 p.m. in this boardroom.
Gentlemen, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your time this evening. We appreciate it. The boardroom was quite warm. The last time we were here, we had coats on.
It's my fault.
Gail, we commend you for that work.
I cranked it.
Before we close out for the day, is there any other business that we need to attend to?
We don't have any business. We do have some things coming up.
Quite a lot in January.
First of all, just want to go over the fact that we are canceling our January 3rd meeting. I know you've all received an email about that. That meeting's canceled.
That email we got.
Pardon me?
That email I got.
That email you read. Thank you. And we are going to be scheduling, again, with the emails that I sent out to you, a special meeting on January 17th. And we've got, at this present time, we've got 3 items for sure on the agenda.
What date is that?
What day of the week is?
January 17th, Tuesday.
Tuesday, okay.
7 p.m.
Here?
In this boardroom.
Weather permitting.
1-17-17.
Yeah, 1-17-17, 7 p.m. We have Oak Brook Centers coming in for a text amendment to the sign regulations and regarding some wayfinding signage and interior signage and a few other things. And then actually we have 2 applications coming in for the new Michael Jordan restaurant that's going to be at 1225 22nd Street. Cornerstone Group is the parent company. And they are seeking a special use for outdoor dining in front of the building for in 2 areas, kind of split, kind of like the clubhouse a little bit, with 70 seats. And then they are also seeking variations to the sign regulations. They've got some very, how would you explain
swoosh.
It?
Swoosh.
There's
That's
a swoosh.
There's a swoosh.
They won't even notice it because in Oak Brook Terrace when this goes up.
It's very...
It's very classy,
yes.
But it's kind of made so that they can catch it off of I-88 as well. But they'll do their entire presentation for you. That and they're looking for another variation as to the sign height. The sign height and the number of signs they're seeking. Because 1225 is that corner of 22nd Street and the entrance, the access drive off of Spring Road going on to 88. And actually, 1225 is the center building of the other 2, and that's where they're going to be located in there.
Where nobody knows how to cross 22nd Street, and everybody's in the wrong lane because it's skewed, and they run you into, okay, awesome. That's what we need, a big, tall sign there to distract people, right?
Right.
Well, it's not. Like,
no, okay.
You'll see. You'll get it all. But anyway, right. You've got January 3rd off, January 17th here. And that's about all I can think of. Can you think of anything else?
Yeah, I do. I have a question. We a couple of years ago or 3 years ago, we had all the stuff about signage with Village has its own code and everything. We continually get in.
Well, and that's why we're going through that entire zoning ordinance update, because sometimes, as you know, when we've updated our sign regulations, issues do come up. Buildings all have... The buildings there, some of them are dated, and they deal with some of the new things that
built
are
built a sign according to code and
trying
not.
To be seen or deal with building structures and the facade and whatnot.
Right, and technology.
And technology, right. Exactly. Has
because
changed.
the application from GGP.
So technology changed in the last 3 years?
Yeah, well, it's improved. And so the amount, the investment is that they're attempting to do signage that will tell you the number of parking spaces that
that's
are
for
in
Oak Brook Center, right?
Yeah.
But now, and we're, like I said, we're working on the zoning ordinance update. It's at the Plan Commission right now. We're looking at the sign regulations, many areas throughout the code. And as Bob mentioned to you the last time, we're hoping to have in early spring a meeting of the Plan Commission and Zoning Board together to kind of go over all of this, because they've been dealing with this now for about 7 months or longer.
Right.
Reviewing the zoning ordinance update, and then you'll be holding the official public hearing, so
right.
You get to weigh in then.
And there'll be some signage.
There'll be some signage in it. So that's about it. Anything else you can think of? Oh, the only thing is that at our last meeting, too, we do have that text amendment for the parking regs. The report hasn't been submitted yet to the Village Board. When that's done and we get some direction, it'll come back to you, or we'll let you know. That's all I have.
Public comment? Anything public? Trustee Barr, is there anything you want to mention or advise the board?
Good work. I wish every applicant was as responsive and as responsible as Christ Church Hopeful.
Right.
So with that,
happy holidays.
Entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Take a
voice vote.
Aye.
Aye.
Any abstention?
I dare you.
Yeah. Thank you very much.